Thank you very much for inviting me, and I will try to explore what is CTA and the gravitational wave observatories. So let me start with the new window that was recently opened into the universe through gravitational waves. And in particular, I want to say to you that currently the detectors that observe the sky through gravitational wave are currently in a phase of upgrade, and they will start to observe again next year with a better sensitivity. And what was so far the gravitational wave astronomy? So we had three very important run that really start the gravitational wave astronomy. And in each of these run, we increase the sensitivity. That means that we increase the volume of the universe up to which we can observe gravitational wave sources. And in particular, you can see in the box some number that correspond to the binary neutron star merger range. That means the distance up to which we can observe this system, taking into account the sensitivity in the sky and also all the orientation. And you can see that we observe larger and larger volume, and in the future we will observe also larger volume. And this enables us, starting from the first event in which there was the first observation of gravitational wave with the three events, to increase a lot the number of sources. And in particular, in the second run, we arrived to 11 sources and the spectacular GV170817, which include binary neutron star, a binary neutron star merger. And now in the last run, we arrived to 90 events. The majority of them are binary neutron star, binary black hole coalescence. And this means that at least for this type of system, we start to make population studies. So from nothing, we are now able to know the distribution of mass of black hole, stellar mass black hole in binary system, to have some indication about their origin and evolution, and also some information about their spin. But the focus of the talk is, I think, in the case of CTA and gravitational wave, we need to concentrate on the multi-messenger, and the symbol of multi-messenger astrophysics is GV170817. So I will give a brief overview of all the results and what will be the future. So we received this gravitational wave signal. From the gravitational wave signal, it was immediately evident that we were in front of something that was related to neutron star, because one of the most important parameters that we are able to extract from the gravitational wave signal is the mass. And in particular, in this plot, you can see the component mass of this system. And these masses are completely consistent with the masses of the non-neutron star in our galaxy. Another very important parameter that we can extract from the gravitational wave signal is the tidal deformability. So the tidal deformability is important because it's directly connected to the amount of ejected mass. When the two neutron stars are close, they are tidally disrupted. So part of this mass is the mass that gives rise to the electromagnetic emission. And in particular, you can see here that with the gravitational wave, we can start to constrain equation of state. This line corresponds to a different equation of state. And in particular, these are the harder equation of state, and these are the softer equation of state. So already with this signal, we were able to rule out the most stiff equation of state. And so this gravitational wave is a really promising way to see the interiors of neutron stars. Then there was the fantastic detection of Fermi that was confirmed almost immediately by Integral. So this connection among binary neutron star merger and short GRB. And from an observational point of view, this object was exactly what we classified as short GRB. And then many, many months of observation that show us something really very interesting, an increase of the flux for many, many months. And this increase of the flux for many, many months in all the bands, so radio, optical, and X-ray, can be explained by two models, so by two scenarios. One, a mildly relativistic isotropic dark flow, so a choked jet in which we have a radial distribution of the velocity, but at the same time, this increase of the flux can be explained also with a structured jet, so a jet faster in the center and slower in the border. So the way in which we were able to discriminate among these two scenarios was using the radio observation, and in particular VLBI, because radio observation enabled us to really look at the source with the right resolution. And we were able to constrain the source size less than 2 milliseconds. That means that this can rule it out the isotropic mildly relativistic outflow. So many, many observations in all the band plus radio enable us to say that with GV170817, we were in front of a jet and a structured jet. Okay, so the thermal part now, when we have two neutron stars, they are tidal disruption, we have an environment very rich of neutrons, so a very high density of neutrons, we have the right temperature for the nucleosynthesis of heavy elements, and in particular lanthanides and actinides. At the same time, we have also other components of the ejecta, for example, in the interface linked to the accretion disk that power the jet. In this part of the, in this component of this ejected material, we have higher temperature, so weak interaction, and we form elements, but not so heavy like the lanthanides or actinides. And so what we expected was a blue component at the beginning for the component in which we have a higher weak interactions. And on the other side, we expected also a red component for the component in which we really can form very heavy elements. And what we observed was blue component in the first 2 days and red component. And here you can see also the spectra, the fantastic spectra that we took with the VLTX shooter. And here indeed there are the absorption features that indicate exactly the presence of very heavy elements. So on the basis of what we know today about the merge rate of neutron star and also the brightness of this source and also the evolution, we can say that binary neutron star merger is one of the major channel of formation of heavy elements in the universe. So GV170817 was really crucial because combining the gravitational wave and the electromagnetic emission, we know better about jet in GRB, and we know that there is this connection among gravitational wave and short GRB, and so binary neutron star merger and short GRB. We know better about nucleosynthesis in the universe. At the same time, so we can also use the electromagnetic side to constrain equation of state, so we can use both the messenger to constrain equation of state and know better about the interiors of neutron star. Using the, when we identify the host galaxy, we can also use the redshift of the galaxy and the distance from the gravitational wave to estimate the Hubble constant. Now we have big errors, so we are not making cosmology with the precision of supernova or CMB, but with many of these observations, we can really start to make a cosmology with a completely different way. So we can also see what gravitational wave will say about the tension among CMB and supernovae. Estimate of the Hubble constant. And we start also to know better what is the relation among the galaxy and the sources of gravitational waves. So we start to understand better what is compact object formation and evolution. And now I go to another very interesting event that happened very recently. And I think this is very interesting because open a new scenario also for electromagnetic counterpart of gravitational waves. So before Christmas this year, there was a GRB, and this GRB, from the point of view of the high energy, is perfectly a long GRB. So this is what observed Swift, Fermi, and this is the position of this GRB in the hardness ratio T90 plot, and you see that is exactly in the position of long GRB. It's a minute duration GRB, has a long tail similar to the extended emission in GRB, but already if you look to the prompt and the bright spikes, they last more than 12 seconds. And this is an object that is close, is 350 megaparsec and about 10 kiloparsec from the center of the galaxy. Why this object is very interesting? Because if you look at the optical data, in the position of the long GRB, there was a kilonova. So here you see all the optical data collected, and in this paper they show the best fit of the data with a kilonova emission, and with the dashed line you can see the kilonova observed for GV170817, and you can see that really these data reproduce well, so are really very similar to what was observed for GV170817, a bit more blue at the beginning, and this is also consistent with the fact that this was observed on axis. And so the authors also examined other scenarios like supernovae, but really kilonova seems to be a solid observational results. So this put in challenge the dichotomy that the typical connection short, long, and different progenitors. So make more complex the classification scheme of GRB. And in particular, the authors were analyzing local GRB, and they say that about 10% of local long GRB can be merger of binary neutron star. So that we have a contamination in the long GRB of mergers. So this is important because increase also the rate of joint detection that we can expect in the next years. So there is also another very interesting work about this object because they found a precursor, and this precursor seems to show signature of quasi-periodic oscillation. And then results from a GSSI group and also with colleague in INAF. So what we discovered was also a very interesting GEV emission for these sources, is a significant detection. And is, as you can see here, is a detection that we start to observe, because in reality here this upper limit is due to observational condition, but what we observe is this emission that lasts for about 10 to the 4 second, that start about 6 kiloseconds after the merger and last for a long time. So it's a late emission. And here you can see all our best fit of all the data that we collected. We have also radio data, and we also ask XMM data, for which we have an upper limit, and also for the radio. And here you can see the best fit of all our data in X-ray and also the optical. This is the take into account the forward shock plus the in the optical band plus the kilonova component. And what you see here is the Fermi LAT detection that we had, and you can see here that we have an excess. Here you can see the spectral distribution, and while the first point can be explained also with the forward shock, so we can say that this is not the second point, the red point is really very distant, and so we can claim really a significant excess in the GV. And so we think that this is very interesting. And to explain this excess with respect to the forward shock, so the synchrotron emission, the standard synchrotron emission that we use to explain the multiband observation for GB. So to interpret this, this excess, we can say that this excess can be explained by external inverse quantum, and in particular the seed photon can be the kilonova photon, and the electron cannot be the one of the relativistic jet that gives rise to the afterglow, because this is too much expanded to explain a kilonova, a GB emission at 10 to the 4 seconds. So we need electrons that are more close to the kilonova photosphere, and so we need to invoke the presence of a low power jet that is emitted at late times. That is not something that is not usual in GB. So many features of GB are explained using the presence of this low power jet ejected at late times. I think that this is a very interesting new detection, because it was not detected for GB170817 because this object was off axis, but it's very interesting because it's a new GV counterpart that I think is really interesting for Fermilat, but also for the future mission concept like Astrogram or Amigo, because they will have also better sensitivity with respect to Fermilat. So future gravitational wave astronomy. Now I go directly to the era of Einstein telescope. And what I want to say, okay, Einstein telescope will be this, this observatory, triangular shape, underground, cryogenic, was insert in the S3 roadmap, so is in the priority of Europe. And what means Einstein telescope with respect to today? I show you the what is important. So first of all, Einstein telescope will be a factor 10 better sensitivity at all frequency with respect to, so in the plot you can see here the sensitivity of LIGO, CAGRA, and Virgo that we expect 405, and this is the most optimistic one. So a factor 10 at all frequency, but also very important, we will explore low frequency. So going, increasing the frequency and also going to lower frequency means that we can explore the early universe. So we can explore binary black hole up to the dark ages. And why we need the low frequency? Because when we observe a gravitational wave, the mass is reshifted. And so also what we observe now, so 30 solar masses, black hole, when we go to the early universe, their mass is at low frequency. So the signal is at low frequency. So we really need the low frequency to explore the early universe. And what we will do with Einstein telescope is really population studies along the cosmic history. So we can connect binary neutron star system of compact object with the star formation history, the metallicity, the evolution of the universe. I give you the number to give you an idea. So here you can see the in blue is the population of binary neutron star and the arrow of binary black hole coming out from population synthesis code that are able to reproduce what we observe today of binary neutron star and binary black hole. And we use a Fisher matrix approach for the detection detection of gravitational wave signal. We use a GVUFISH, that is a code that we developed and is publicly available. And what you can see here is that the number of detection will be huge. So we will have 10 to the 5 binary neutron star detection per year and 10 to the 5 binary black hole detection per year. So the black hole that we observe today. And we will have the same amount more or less with neutron star black hole. So we really we'll have a huge number of events and a huge number of alerts for the astronomical community. Another important thing, so for the more closed universe, this fact that we will have a better sensitivity means that we will be able really to make an extremely precise parameter estimation. So we can really start to talk about precise gravitational wave astronomy. And this is very, very important, for example, to study tidal deformability, to study the interiors of neutron stars. We will be able also to detect the post-merger. For GV170817, we don't know from the gravitational wave if there was a remnant, a black hole, or a neutron star. With ET, we will be able to detect the post-merger signal, and for sure up to 100 megaparsec, we will be able to understand well what is the remnant. Another important thing, exploring low frequency means also that we can explore really intermediate massive black hole and the merger of intermediate massive black hole you can see here in this plot. And so in connection also with LISA, we can try to understand what is, if really stellar mass black hole are the seeds of massive black hole and how these are connected with supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy. Going to the early universe with the low frequency, we will be able also to see the population of primordial black holes that we expect that increase at higher redshift. And so this is another very interesting astrophysical field that ET can explore. I will show only a few cases of the ET science cases, but I think the most interesting one from the point of view of astrophysics. So for the cosmology, what will happen is that we will have a lot of events like GV170817, and so we can really start to talk about cosmology with gravitational wave, and I will give you some numbers about this. And also we can really test modified gravity at cosmological scale, for example, testing gravitational wave propagation and see if the distance coming from the electromagnetic signal is different from the distance that we can estimate from the gravitational wave side. Multi-messenger. So all what we did for GV170817 can be done with a larger sample of events and along the cosmic history, and we can benefit a lot of the better parameter estimation. So really what show us GV170817 is only the beginning. And in the ET era, we will have a lot of science to be done with many, many events. And also we will have a higher chance to detect core collapse supernovae, newborn neutron stars. So we can really have also many other sources of gravitational wave and electromagnetic counterpart. So for the multi-messenger astronomy, the first important information is sky localization. And so we did simulation, and in particular, ET is extremely interesting because as the low frequency again, with the low frequency, we can use the Earth movement, so with the Earth rotation, so with long signal like the one for binary neutron star, we can localize only with ET, also if ET is observing alone. And we can detect about hundreds of detection per year with a sky localization better than 100 square degree. And for this event, we can have also the early warning. I will come back later on this point of early warning. Okay, so if we have ET plus Cosmic Explorer, the number of detection will be thousands with sky localization less than 10 square degree. And the situation is also better if we have ET plus two Cosmic Explorer, because we can have thousands of detection per year with sky localization less than 1 square degree. So you see how ET in a network of detector will be able to improve the sky localization. So for ET, it will be different with respect to today, because we will have exactly two universes, because, for example, kilonova emission taking into account also the sky localization of gravitational wave, we will not be able to detect a redshift larger than 0.3. And so to detect a counterpart at a larger redshift, we really need the high energy. So close, we will have kilonova, we will benefit of better parameter estimation. And if you want to go to the larger, if we want to have a counterpart at larger redshift, we need the high energy. And so the gamma ray.
High energy.
So now I will give you some number. And in particular, we did some simulation with the Vera Rubin Observatory. If we use Vera Rubin in survey mode, we cannot do a lot for kilonova detection. But if we think about observation, so asking target of opportunity, if we look to all the objects that are detected with a sky localization less than 40 square degree, what we can have is that we can have a few tenths of joint detection per year using 10% of the Vera Rubin telescope time. Now it's a huge number, this 10%, but I think that in 10 years from now, it's not so crazy idea to use 10% of the Vera Rubin observatory to follow up gravitational wave, because almost all the science goal of Vera Rubin will be reached. And so cosmology, we can have really cosmology with a very good precision. High energy. So here I show you a work that was driven by one of my PhD students, so Samuele Ronchini. It is a comprehensive study in which we use prompt and afterglow emission, and we try to understand the perspectives of joint detection. And what we did was to take a binary neutron star population to normalize this population to Fermi GVM, short GLB sample. And with the mock MCMC, we also find the optimal parameters for the GLB emission, able to explain all the observation that we have so far for short GLB. And then we started to make a joint, to estimate the joint detection. So if we take gamma ray monitor and we use them in survey mode, what we can say is that almost all short GLB will have a gravitational wave counterpart. And so I think this is really very nice, very interesting, because in future we will have really a multi-messenger astronomy with a lot of signal. And in particular, with only T, we have about 70% of joint detection. With T plus Cosmic Explorer, almost 100%. Then, depending on the satellite, we will have tens to hundreds of detection per year. And I show you for different detectors what are our prediction. And in particular, here you see that there are some instruments that will give tens of detection and others that will give hundreds of detection. But I want to underline that it will be extremely important to have the sky localization. So the ones that have a small number but can give us the sky localization are crucial, because are these satellite that will give the sky localization then to drive the ground-based follow-up. Now I go on the afterglow, on the X-ray afterglow. Here we use the modeling that use the forward shot and the high latitude emission. And we analyzed what happened in survey mode for different instruments. So ISAM probe, GAMOV, TCUS, TAP. And you can see that in survey mode already we can have tens of detection. And if we use a pointing mode, so we select all the sources with a sky localization less than 100 square degree, we point our telescope, we can have also, in the case of ET plus Cosmic Explorer, also 100 of detection, but with some caveat. So first of all, we need to be in the source immediately, because the afterglow is decreasing rapidly, and so we can lose a lot of detection, for example, if we are 1 hour later, and 4 hours later is the number reduced a lot. And another important caveat is that what are the triggers to follow? So if we take all the objects that have a good sky localization, the number is huge. Look at this. So if the number of sources with the sky localization less than 100 square degrees are really a huge number. So this means, what are the ones that we need to follow? So if we make a selection based on viewing angle and distance, this is also not enough to reduce so much the number of events. So one of the most important things will be, on the basis of the science case, on the basis of the instrument, try to to make a prioritization of the trigger. So this will be crucial, and I think require a lot of work of the astronomical community together with the gravitational wave side. From the gravitational wave side, it will be necessary to send more information with respect to today and try to make a parameter estimation as fast as possible with very, very rapid update. So why are important wide field monitors? First of all, because they increase the number of detections that we can have in the gamma ray. But if you look to this plot, you can see that we can have a large increase of these gray objects that are the ones that are off-axis. So X-ray will allow us, wide field monitoring X-ray will allow us to really see objects that are more off-axis, so to understand better the jet in GB. And also, these are very important because they have a good sky localization, so they can drive the ground-based follow-up and also send alert to more sensitive instruments like ATINA, that is the only one that can then monitor the emission at later time. So now I go in the last part of my talk on the synergies with CTA. So we are starting some work on this. And I think all of this was, we are really more enthusiastic about the synergy after the MAGIC and DES detection of GRB in very high energy. In particular, the detection of very high energy emission from the afterglow. And in particular, I show you that with the Einstein telescope, we can try also to detect the prompt emission, not only the afterglow emission, because we can have, as I told you before, pre-alert, so alert before the merger. And so we can use really early warning alerts from ET. So IT can give alerts, and we show you with what is the sky localization pre-merger. And so what, in some sense, CTA can follow of the gravitational wave signal. This work is driven by Bijavit Manjari, that is one of my postdocs at the JSSI. So, okay, if we take the binary neutron star event up to a redshift equal to 1.5, that is more or less what CTA can see, we can see here what is the sky localization pre-merger. And in particular, the sky localization is here. Here I show only 110 square degrees. We have all the sky localization in our simulation. The population is the same that we use for the work on high energy, so X-ray and gamma. And here what you see is the number of events per year that we can observe with sky localization less than 100 square degrees and less than 10 square degrees. 15 minutes before the merger, 5 minutes before the merger, 1 minute before the merger, and at the merger. And this is considering all orientation, but for the very high energy, we have the emission when the jet is pointing to us. So here you can see the same table with the viewing angle less than 10 square degrees, so on-axis observation. And here you can see the number. In this plot, you can see the evolution of the number of detection per year as a function of the sky localization. So it's similar to the table, but explore more sky localization in our simulation for ET plus Cosmic Explorer and ET alone. So here the number that you see here, for example, 1 minute before the merger, we have number that are not bad. But again, there are some caveats. So this number, we don't know a priori what are the signals that are pointing to us. And so you look at the top of the plot, and for example, in this case in which we have 300 sources, we have 1,000 of detection to follow up. And then there is another caveat that is also the CTA duty cycle. This is the gravitational wave. We consider a duty cycle for the gravitational wave, but it's around 85%. But so this number reduce also because we need to use the duty cycle of CTA. But I think it's already very interesting because you can follow a lot of object because CTA will be very fast as a wide field of view. So it's really very the perfect instrument to follow many of these system. But another strategy can be, okay, we have a lot of detection. We make only one shot. We look at the probability of detecting sources. And if we make this type of strategy, following all the sources with a sky localization less than 1 square degree, 1 minute before the merger with only one single observation, we have the possibility to detect 20 very high energy counterpart per year using 10% of the CTA time. So this is a number. We have the plot and everything for different sky localization for many configuration of instrument. For example, ET also plus the current detector, ET plus two cosmic explorer is also more, the number are also better with respect to this one. So then if there is a detection or not depend really on the emitted energy of our source, but I think it's very promising in any case because we have from an observational point of view, the capability to follow up many trigger and to detect sources. And again, if you look at these energies and you compare with the energies of detection for that of the GB already detected by MAGIC and DES, I think that you can understand immediately that CTA will be really extremely interesting working with gravitational wave observatories. And so this is my last slide. I hope to be in time. So I think that the future will be a revolution in our knowledge of early universe, fundamental physics, but also astrophysics of transient instruments that CTA and ET can play really a crucial role in this scenario. So I want to thank everyone, and also I write in this slide the name of all the young people, PhD and postdoc, that are working on many of the results that I show you today.